From the darkness, I called your name. Into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness, you took my shame, buried my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love?
Love so true. And and welcome to Worship with Pekin First. I'm Jim, and I get to serve as directing pastor with this church family whose purpose is to unite everyone with the life-giving power of Jesus. In worship, we open our souls to that life-giving power as God pours his life and love into us. Today, we'll be wrestling with some great questions of faith about communion, which is one of the ways God pours his life into us. Unfortunately, we're not ready to do communion during our online worship, but we look forward to the day when we can commune together, and we want to be eager and ready for that. I hope today helps. To move us toward the word proclaimed, let's prepare to give our hearts, minds, and souls to God as we do worship, as we give our worship to our God. Let the music and the words of this song wash over your soul as our worship team leads us forward. And the line that made my heart jump as I looked over this song is this: "You're falling now like heaven's rain." And since communion is all about the grace of God flowing, heaven's rain is a perfect mind image for how God's grace flows into us from above. Oh God, we welcome you, the healer, into this place, into our lives. Amen.
Welcome the darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance.
God's grace flows and grace finds us. As we prepare to hear a message about why we do communion and why it's important, this next song should help us open our souls to the big why of communion. Why? Because from the heights of heaven, God stepped down to earth to give his life for us. We're amazed. We stand in awe, for we've been changed by the power of the cross. That is what we celebrate when we do communion.
From the darkness, I called your name. Into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness.
You took my shame, buried my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love.
Passages in the New Testament which tell about communion. Today we're using Matthew's account of that Last Supper with Jesus. Please notice that all 12 of the disciples were there, even Judas, and Jesus already knew he'd been betrayed, and yet he still offered himself to all 12 of those men, even Judas. That's an incredible statement of the grace of God, right up there with, "Father, forgive them, they just don't know what they're doing." May we receive his grace as we open up his word. And here it is. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." They were very sad and began to say to him one after the other, "Surely you don't mean me, Lord." And isn't it interesting that they each thought it could be them? They knew what was inside themselves. Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." This is God's word for the people of God, and we say thanks be to God. So one of the things that almost all Christians do, but most Christians don't really know why we do it, or many don't, is communion. Today I hope to answer questions I hope you're asking. What does communion really mean? What's the right way to do communion? How often should we do communion? Why do we do communion? And what's the official United Methodist understanding of communion? To our online friends, I haven't figured out how to do online communion in a way that fits what I believe is a good theology of communion. So I hope this message helps you next time you take communion. I know the bishop has given special permission for us to lead online communion, but I'm just not there yet. So let's spend about 10 or 12 minutes on these five questions and look forward to when we can share together. First, what does communion really mean? Well, that's a tough one. All parts of the body of Christ can't even agree on this. As a part of the body of Christ, I want to put a plug in for us understanding our church's view and us being very gracious toward other views which may be different than ours. Probably the best, most complete, accurate, theologically pure explanation I ever heard was when a fellow pastor told me this story. A well-meaning but lacking in grace church member didn't think communion should be given to children because they just can't really understand the theology of it. So when the 5-year-old boy returned to his seat after taking communion at the altar rail, the well-meaning but lacking in grace church member asked him, "Young man, do you know what communion means?" And with a smug look, she leaned back in her pew, confident that his confusion would make her point for her that kids just can't understand communion. But boy, was she surprised when his eyes lit up and his smile stretched from ear to ear, and he said, "I sure do. It means Jesus loves me and I love him." And to that I say, somebody, anybody, give me a better definition than that. God's love through Jesus is at the very base, the very heart of communion. It's what communion rests on. Celebrating communion is partly celebrating the fact of the crucifixion, which means God loves us enough to give his only son for us. And that, not after we clean ourselves up and become worthy, but now, sinners that we are. Remember, Jesus even offered the cup and the bread to Judas. What does it really mean? God loves us and proved it through Jesus. Every time we share it, we remember that fact. God loves us and gave his son up for us. That is powerful love, which makes an impact on life, which makes life different when we live by it. Secondly, what's the right way to do communion? Some churches share communion by passing it in the pews or the chairs every single time. And that's a wonderful symbol of the unity of the body of Christ. All worshipers share the bread and the juice together at the same time. I love that symbolism. We are the body of Christ. We share that. We're together in it. I love that when we do it together. I'm glad we do that here. Some churches share communion by inviting people to receive the bread and the juice at the altar with the opportunity to kneel there and pray if they want to. I love that symbolism. I love to kneel at the altar. Kneeling is a way to do a physical act to show that my soul is obedient to God. You kneel in the presence of your King, your Lord, which we don't really have in our country and haven't for well over 200 years, and hardly any of you remember kings and lords. But kneeling in the presence of someone who is sovereign over you is an accepted way to show your willing humbleness in their presence. Kneeling to show your willing obedience to God has long been practiced by Christians as a way to do a physical act to show what's going on in our souls. I'm glad we do that here. Some churches alternate, sometimes at the altar, sometimes in the pews or chairs, each signifying something about life in the body of Christ. I'm glad we do that here. My mom used to tell a story that's both humorous and sad. Mom and Dad had moved to a new town, and Dad, being a pastor, he prepared communion for the church and invited people to come to the altar to receive the bread and juice and pray if they'd like. A woman in the congregation was so mad about that, she got up and she left. On her way out, she huffed and she announced to the woman in the entryway who was making her way back into worship, she said, "You tell that new pastor that Methodists don't take communion at the altar, and I speak for the entire church." She didn't know, how could she, that the woman on her way in was my mom. She did tell the pastor, but not with the attitude the woman wanted. "Are you kidding me? Methodism was built at the altar of prayer." I'm so glad our church alternates, both in the chairs and in the altar, at the altar rail. They are great ways to show important aspects of our faith. There are also varying methods of actually receiving the bread and the juice. Some churches used to practice intention, which was dipping the bread in the juice, because some of the Bible verses refer to dipping in the cup. Most have gone away from that now for virus reasons. Some churches use one loaf of bread with the worshiper or the worship leader breaking off a piece. Some use already cut up squares of bread. Again, there's not a right or wrong way to do that. Thirdly, how often should we do communion? Again, there's not a right or wrong answer. Some churches think we shouldn't worship at all unless we do communion. Some churches think we shouldn't do it all the time because it would lose its specialness if you do it every time you worship, and we certainly don't want people to just go through the motions with it. Because of the United Methodist belief that an ordained elder must preside over communion, because in the early days when pastors traveled the circuit and they couldn't get to all their churches except about once a quarter, once every 3 months, early Methodists only got communion about once every 3 months. But over the years, most Methodist churches saw that quarterly communion was for a time when pastors weren't there very often. And since pastors now get to settle in a parish instead of traveling around, most Methodist churches now take communion monthly. Again, there's not a specific number of times you're supposed to do it. Fourthly, why do we do communion? Well, the easy answer is that Jesus tells us to. He tells us to baptize, and he tells us to remember his sacrifice when we break bread. So baptism and communion for Protestants are the two sacraments, the two things Jesus told us to observe. Our Catholic brothers and sisters believe there are more sacraments than the two, and I kind of agree with them that marriage, at least, ought to be a sacrament. But more than that, he told us to do it, why do we do it? And then another way of asking is this: what difference does it make? Or what does it do for us? Again, there's some mystery in this. And when I say mystery, I mean that we may not have it totally figured out, but we believe God is in the experience. So the best answer I can give is that when we receive communion, we are receiving the grace of God. And that begs the question, do we only receive the grace of God in communion? If we receive the grace of God in other ways, then why do we need to do communion? That's where the mystery is. Here's what I believe. I believe that God's grace comes to us in different ways, through prayer, through worship, through incredible music, through giving, through serving, and other ways. And I believe God's grace comes to me through communion. So since I believe that God's grace is delivering life to my soul, I'll take grace however I can get it, as often as I can get it, in whatever vehicle it comes. Instead of saying, I don't need communion because I get grace other ways, I'm going to say, heck yes, if communion delivers God's grace, then sign me up, I am in. Why would we ever limit the ways God's grace comes into our lives? So what's the official United Methodist understanding of communion? Well, there are some denominations and faith bodies who believe that communion is just a symbol. There's nothing really spiritually happening there, but the bread and juice represent Jesus' body and blood. Another major part of the body of Christ believes that the bread actually becomes the body, and the juice actually becomes the, blood of Jesus in substance. So by the pastor, the priest's prayer, a transformation happens. The bread becomes the body of Jesus. The juice becomes the blood of Jesus. So when we eat the bread and drink the juice, we are actually receiving into our bodies the body and blood of Jesus. It's flesh and blood. But the official United Methodist understanding is this. It's neither of those extremes. We believe in the real presence of Christ and the overall experience of communion. In my mind, what this is really saying is we don't understand the mystery of how it happens, but we have this really strong belief that Christ is present in the experience of communion, delivering grace differently than at other times. It's an acknowledgement that we don't know all the ways the Spirit of God moves, but we know it does move. And we believe strongly that God's Holy Spirit is moving in communion. And here's Reverend Jim's humble but accurate, inspired, hopefully biblical, theological guess. When the pastor prays a blessing over the bread and juice, somehow they are infused with God's grace, so that when we eat the bread and drink the juice, we are receiving the grace of God. And again, why would we limit how God's grace comes to us by saying, if I don't understand it all, I'm not doing it. I don't understand why Lisa loves me so much, but she does. I'll take it and I'll return it. So here's how I like to teach communion. It's the three R's, like reading, writing, and arithmetic, which I never really understood because writing is actually a W and arithmetic is actually an A. But be that as it may, here are the three R's of communion. Remember. In 1 Corinthians 11:24, it says, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." This means remember the act of God, which is the giving of his son Jesus for us, for you. Remember that, because it's incredible. It's amazing. It's earth-changing. The God of the universe loves you and gave himself up for you. That's what it means. So when you eat the bread, remember the fact of God's love for you. Secondly, receive. Jesus said, take and eat and drink from it, all of you. In other words, he's offering himself. That's grace. Receive it. Receive his forgiveness. When you eat the bread and drink the juice, you are receiving grace. So take it. Receive it. And thirdly, recommit. Communion is a perfect time, every time, to confess your sin to God and to recommit your life to your God. He gave his life for you, and yet you aren't yet fully committed, probably, or at least you want to be, but you keep doing things that show you're not there yet. So when you take communion, take the time to recommit by saying, okay, Lord, you committed your life to me. I'm committing my life to yours. Let us pray. Thank you, great God, for giving us yourself through Christ Jesus. And thank you for the celebration of the sacrament of communion in which we receive your grace, by which we receive your love and your forgiveness. So help us appreciate and love all the more as we go along the sacrament of communion in which we remember that you gave yourself to us, in which we receive your grace flowing into us, and by which we recommit our lives to you. In Jesus' name we offer ourselves. Amen. And commitment to your God through your church. Many of us by now are experiencing how fun and joyous it is to be generous to God through our church. We love writing that check or clicking enter if we give online, or maybe just knowing your gift is going through with automatic online giving. However you do it, I'm convinced you're experiencing the fun and joy of giving. I have to tell you a story of what happened last week when Lauren and I were picking up kids in the van for vacation Bible school. A few kids ran across the street when they saw the van coming. They were eager and excited to come to VBS. They piled in, jabbering all the while, and a little girl was left alone by the curb. And one of the kids remarked, "She's not coming." Then about a second later, she bolted across the street, ran up to the van, and announced assertively, "I'm coming too." Problem was, we didn't know her. We just can't pick up random kids and put them in the van. I said, "Honey, I'm sorry. I can't take you without permission from your parents." She pointed and said, "My mom's over there." I knew that we're supposed to have sign-up sheets and waivers, but my heart said, "Go talk to the mom." We did, and she let her daughter come with us. And she was exposed to Christian church people and the good news of God's love through Jesus, and she had a blast. So thank you. Some of your tithes to your God go to help keep that van running and full of gas so we can pick up kids, youth, adults, whoever, and help them experience the love of Jesus. As we offer God our next song, it's a perfect one to go along with a message about communion, the why of communion, because God gives himself for us, and that's reflected in many of the words of this song, such as, "His heart is good, his heart is kind. The cross proves he's on our side. We are the sons and the daughters of God." Amen.
Before he spoke creation, the God of heaven knew our names. Formed in his reflection, we are his glory on display. And his heart is good, he is always kind. With the cross he proved he is on my side. We are the sons, we are the daughters of God. No matter where we go, we're close to the Father's heart. And though we stumble, he will not let us fall. We are the Lord's and he will never forsake his own. Sons, we are the daughters of God.
His love he lavished on us and called us children of the King. And in his loving kindness, he chose the lowly and the weak.
And his heart is good, he's always kind. With the cross he proved he's on my side. We are the sons, we are the daughters of God. Father's heart.
wrestled with questions about communion. You'll be sure to want to worship with us next week as we wrestle with questions about baptism, such as, what's the right way to baptize? What does baptism really mean? Why do we baptize babies when they don't understand it and can't remember it? I look forward to worshiping with you as we wrestle down the meaning of the great sacrament of baptism. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And all God's people sing glory,
every glory, child,
hallelujah, he reigns,
hallelujah,
he reigns.
It's
all God's people singing glory,
every
glory,
child,
hallelujah,
he
reigns,
hallelujah,
he reigns.
It's
all God's children singing glory,
every
glory,
child,
hallelujah,
he reigns.
And all God's people singing glory,
every child.